The following feature presentation is part of the SKYwalking Network.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
Best day ever!
Secrets lair.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, Never Never Land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
D23 Expo, day number two. Check! We are here with our esteemed panel, and then what we're going to do, we'll introduce them, and then we'll go into our highlights before we go into the big mega Lucasfilm Marvel 20th Century Fox giant panel.
All right, so we have Bryn MacKinnon and her son Ivan. Hello.
From
Totally Tell Me Everything. Yay. Speak a little bit, Bryn. Say hi.
Hi. I'm so happy to be here. We missed yesterday's, and we had such a great day today. We can't wait to talk about it.
Oh, exciting.
Hello.
Nice. We also have Courtney and Kelly Turckel from the Neverland Clubhouse.
Hi. Hey, everyone.
And Mike Celestino from Who's the Bossk podcast and Laughing Place.
I just want to say, as tired as I was last night, if you heard me on the previous episode, multiply that by about 6.5. That's where I'm at right now.
So, here.
I will think I'm funnier, but I will be less funny. So you do the math and we'll take it from there.
Nice.
Well, since the show is going out tonight, we'll have you come by the house and ADR some of your lines.
You got it.
Well, we'll write up a whole nice script for you. Have it all ready for you?
Punch it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so now let's go around and talk about our highlights and personal favorite moments.
And before that, we just want to say that we are sponsored by Small World Vacations. And they are a diamond-level Disney vacation travel agency that can help you plan your trip to Disney parks around the world. So head to smallworldvacations.com and for a no-obligation price quote and tell them that what?
Skywalking through Neverland sent you.
Skynet.
We got to ask them if they're getting calls, people saying, Skynet, then like hanging up.
Well, I know me and Courtney have least planned 3 trips with them.
So.
All right, we have 1 trip planned with Small World Vacations. Mike and Bryn?
Not yet, but Ivan and I today were just talking about maybe we need to go to Walt Disney World in a couple of years. So
well,
we'll
and definitely be who are you going to call?
Small World Vacations.
Oh, that was loaded. Ivan, I set you up there.
Ivan's going to call Ghostbusters, and I'll call Small World Vacations.
Yeah, I think Small World Vacations may have a couple of Ghostbusters working for them. All right, Mike, what was one of your highlights of the day, day number 2?
I met Doug Chang in the Lucasfilm booth and told him that I bought the giant Hasbro Razor. That's not true. Actually, my boss bought it for me so I could review it. But I am a big fan of the design of the Razor Crest, and I told him so, and he was appreciative, and he took a photo with me.
Now, Doug Chang, he is a concept artist of The Mandalorian, the prequels, Galaxy's Edge, and one of the nicest guys you'd ever want to talk to.
Incredibly kind, yes.
Was he there speaking, or he just happened to be there?
He was chatting with some other folks. I don't know if they were Lucasfilm people or what, but I felt bad interrupting him, but I did anyway.
That's kind of the name of the game. You see someone, yeah, you feel bad about it, and you know what? Yeah, apologize now, because I'm sure he's listening.
I'm sorry, Doug. Thank you, though, for posing for a photo.
All right, see? You've been released of that pressure.
Thank you.
Okay, Courtney and Kelly.
Hi. our favorite highlight?
Yeah, highlight of the day.
It can be different.
The Santa Clauses panel. Oh. I love that movie, and it was so fun to hear about the new series that's coming to Disney Plus the day after my birthday. I get a birthday present. So November 16th, it's coming to Disney Plus this year. And Tim Allen is as funny as he ever was. And his daughter, his real life daughter, plays his daughter in this show. So
now, is she an actress or nepotism?
No, they just kind of said, hey, we want you to read these lines. But they did make her go through the audition process, mm-hmm. but she ended up being the best out of all the girls that they auditioned. So
nice.
Well, Tim said that he wanted her to be just like an extra elf and say, hey, Santa, just as a little like Easter egg for people that know that he's her daughter. But she read the lines of the daughter and they were like, wait, she's kind of good. And then they kept calling her back and then they were like, are we really going to test her? Yeah, we'll put her through. And then she ended up stealing the part.
Yeah. Oh.
So, yeah, it's going to be, it looks fabulous and it's a six episodes, so. This is the Santa Claus with Tim Allen and Elizabeth Mitchell.
I think Santa Claus these days, and I think of that awesome movie with Kurt Russell and Goldie Hawn.
Tim Allen is the only Santa Claus.
Except for the real Santa Claus.
Well, he said he was on set.
Oh, yeah. Okay, all right.
Tim Allen made a point of saying they filmed in the North Pole with the real Santa Claus watching over him.
Oh, so he was like a consultant?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess he can't get any better than that. Perfect. All right, Bryn MacKinnon.
All right, so a highlight from today. So it wasn't a panel necessarily because we actually didn't go to that many panels, but just the looking at all the cosplays, we saw so many cool, cool, cool cosplays, especially there was a whole, what's the name? There was a whole Cruella group that was amazing. I think
there was one that had a really, it had a really, really long dress that was, like, very flowy and fun. There's a picture, but.
Yeah. Were there 101 of them?
There weren't 101. Oh. So disappointing.
Were they all carrying puppies?
No, not a puppy. Not a puppy in the group.
And some dogs on shoulders.
Yeah, there were really elaborate ones, like from the live-action movie. Super cool stuff like that. So I was just obsessed with the cosplays today.
Okay, Ivan is showing Sarah and the Turckels. What is that? Now, Ivan, what was that picture right there? Because you showed everyone else, not me.
Cruella.
This is a picture of this is like Mr. Cruella.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that. Look at that cape.
Yeah, I saw him.
Yeah,
I saw him walking like along the hall, and he was owning the walk.
Oh my gosh, he was out there for a really long time.
He could walk a whole 10 feet, and then a whole crowd of people would be like, "Hey, can I take a picture? Hey, can I take a picture?" And then he'd walk a whole 2 feet, and then again.
Now his upper body looks like he's wearing like a Captain Crunch outfit, like Captain Cruella.
He definitely put his own flavor into it, but he also has on his like belt area, he has like a scroll that he can unroll, and it says the past. I think it said the at the top. Yeah. Anyway, super cool. And also we saw him at one moment. There was a little girl who was also dressed as Cruella as a younger person when she was kind of like starting to, you know, make her own way in the fashion world or whatever. And she had kind of like the trash train, you know, on her outfit.
Like
magazines and newspaper clippings and stuff. And so they took a picture together, which was fantastic. I have a not so great picture that I can share. But okay, wait, don't do that because I have the
name. All right, so the panel on diversity.
The panel was called ABC's On the Red Carpet Storyteller's Spotlight. And it celebrates the magic of Disney with diverse voices from Disney Plus, Marvel Studios, Marvel Comics, Hulu, Freeform, Disney Channel, National Geographic, and Disney on Broadway. And so we did stand by for this because we didn't get into it originally.
But we were actually first in the line.
We were the first in line on standby. We were very proud of ourselves. And there weren't a lot of people who had planned to go to it, I guess, because they let us in right away and we were in the second row. And so it started out with some young poets from the Get Lit poetry program, which Ivan's older sister has done.
That's really cool.
It was really cool. And they did this really cool poem together. It was like three kids doing
it was Disney related, but also like talking about like their different cultures.
yeah, yeah, their experiences from being from different cultures. And it was a slam poetry style, slam style poetry. And excuse me. And then they brought out some actresses and people who are working currently or have worked currently on like Disney Channel shows or whatever, diverse backgrounds. And that was really cool.
There was a veterinarian, a...
There's that show on Disney Plus that's like the vets, these two veterinarians who...
Is it from Hawaii or no?
From, no. Ah, what's he?
Dr. Cole?
No. Oh, what was it?
All right, well...
Should we just skip?
Okay, just,
yeah, yeah. So, he was great. He's one of our favorites.
Jump ahead.
But so then the room got weird and they kind of like shoved... And I'm going to pass it over to Ivan.
All right, so, and then the host of the thing told...
Okay, so anyway, the woman who was hosting, she, like, said goodbye to the three people who were there before, and then the room got weird, and she kind of walked off, and I thought, did something bad happen, and they're going to make us evacuate her? Like, the tone was weird. And then she came back out, and she says, you know, I need you to all get on your feet. And I'm thinking, she's going to make us leave. Mm-hmm. And she said, And then they brought out like Wakanda Forever people. It was Letitia White, right? Oh. Letitia Wright,
yeah.
Winston Duke, who plays M'Baku, and Nate Moore, who is the
producer of Black Panther,
Wakanda Forever. And we were freaking out because it was not a big place, and it was like anyway. They came out and
five or six rows were filled
at the time. Yeah, but then people filled in a bit more after. But it was wild, and they were so great, and they talked about just the movie a bit and making like their journeys throughout their careers and what made them want to be storytellers. Because the panel was all about storytelling and being storytellers.
It was actually really cool.
It was super cool. Anyway, that
was smaller panels that you happen to just get into.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
That makes your whole convention.
Yeah, so that's been a lot of our experience in the last 2 days is that because we didn't get into any big panels at all. And so we've just been discovering things here and there and like really cool stuff has come out of it. And we're just walking around and like landing on something and it's been fantastic.
Yeah, that's always the advice we give people going to a celebration or a D23. You may not get into the panel you really want, but you'll get into a panel that is much better than the original panel that
yeah.
you really were hoping to get into.
Yeah.
And it's smaller, so you get more out of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and speaking of today, my favorite moment, like, I just came from Zootopia Plus panel. Yeah, and this one, it wasn't full either as well, and it only had the two directors of Zootopia Plus series, which is coming November to Disney Plus. It's made up of 6 shorts that are based on different genres, like classic genres, like rom-com or the Godfather type or film noir, things like that. And so we had Josie Trinidad, and she started as a story editor way back on The Princess and the Frog. And then she and Trent Corey, he's a director, and he started on Frozen as an animator for Olaf. As a supporting animator. And so both of them have moved up in the studio, and thanks to Disney's programs on, you know, like pitch programs and things like that, they've both moved up in their various departments and teamed up for Zootopia Plus. And just them two together on stage, like, they have such a fun chemistry together. Like, you can tell, you can see them in story meetings just, like, banging out ideas. It's like, I want to give these two a feature film because I think it would be so fun. And so this panel, even though it was a big room, it felt more intimate because it was just the two of them talking about their career and then talking about the various shorts. And then they showed us 2 of the shorts for Zootopia Plus. One of them was based on The Godfather and one of them was based on, based on an action film. And so what the whole basis of this series, and I didn't know this until I came to the panel, is that each of these 6 shorts are set in the timeline of Zootopia the film. So there's actually little moments, like the one we saw, that's the action one, features Judy's mom and dad. Right as Judy leaves to go to Zootopia for the first time, she boards the train and they say goodbye. And so you see that in the short. And then one of their little bunnies, one of the mom and dad's little bunnies, hops aboard the train and like and is zoomed off. And so they have to go on adventure together, the mom and the dad, to save the little kid. And along the way, it's like maybe 7-8 minutes, but along the way, it's like a whole character arc for the two of them. And it's just adorable. So yeah, it was really fun panel, and I really enjoyed it. It's the kind of panel you expect from D23 Expo at this point. You get like a really nitty-gritty in-depth into the making of something, and I love that.
Yeah.
All right, for me, I'm going to go with the nitty-gritty of Spider-Man 60 Amazing Years. I was so looking forward to this because I'm now reading the old 1960s comics on Marvel Unlimited. So this is going to go from that period to current day because they're always having these new Spider-Man comics popping up. It's like, what is this new Spider-Man? How does this relate to the old Spider-Man? Is it still Peter Parker? I don't know, but this was going to answer all those questions. And the first question was, who came into Spider-Man during the comics, the animated shows, the movies? It's like, how about the Electric Company, the Spidey? I know you weren't going to forget about that. So I just had a good time going through all the iterations of Spider-Man and all the key comics and the different, there's like 1,500 Spider-Man titles out there, and they went through some of them, and I never really got the good gist of how is this different from this different, is this all in the same time frame, but I think they were thinking everyone in the audience is already going to know this stuff, because they were asking questions like, oh, on issue 185 on page 3, someone would say, Gwen Stacy. It's like, well, okay, I'm out. I'm up. But I had a great time because I just love Spider-Man, just seeing the iterations once again and seeing the trailers for upcoming comics. And the two hosts were very personable and very energetic, which is what you need at one of these conventions, because I've seen a lot of, well, a panel or two, which we'll get into in a couple of seconds, where the panelists or the guests, just they're monosyllabic. But these guys were just so into Spider-Man. In fact, when this one guy couldn't say Spider-Verse, he had to say Spider-Verse. He had to sing it every single time. And once he didn't say Spider-Verse, the co-host said, oh, stop right there. This is the first time in years I've ever heard you say Spider-Verse without singing it. So it was fun, informative. They gave us some nice comics on the way out. One comic had Spider-Man talking with Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck in a little play area. I don't know what that was. I shoved it in a bag and off I ran. So,
I have a question. That was one of the panels we wanted to get into today that we were too late to get into.
Yeah, that was jammed.
Yeah.
Oh, the guy even said this is the fullest this room has ever been.
And I think they were surprised by that because we showed up an hour ahead of time to get in the standby line, and it was closed. And they kept telling us, like, oh, just come 30 minutes before to get in the standby. But an hour ahead of time, it was already closed.
It came like 15 minutes to the diversity one, and no one was there.
But so because we couldn't go, we went to the D23 Expo Live area, and they were showing it. And when they were asking at the beginning, like, where'd you come in on the...
Yeah.
And I was like, well, kind of animated show, I guess, if you count, like, Electric Company as an animated show. But I was waiting for someone to say, like, Electric Company. Were you the one who said Electric Company?
I said it at the same time. I think the guy in back of me said it, like, a fraction of a second beforehand.
Cool.
Like, nope.
Cool. Well, I was on the live stage going, like, hey, what about the Electric Company? And then I raised my hand once he said it. So, anyway, thank you for doing that.
Yeah, I was really hoping. It was a great panel, an A-plus panel. It would have been an A++ had they brought out the Spidey from the Electric Company.
Oh, yeah.
He's like another one of my white whales trying to get onto the show because I just want to hear those stories.
Yeah.
But I just want to see some... But then again, there were like 15 Spider-Man cosplayers right in back of me. So didn't really need another one.
Right on.
I was just going to say the exact same thing that you asked him.
Okay, cool.
Were you one of the people who raised your hand?
Okay, so now let's get into this.
I didn't share my...
Oh.
I didn't share.
You grouped us in together.
Okay, you're the Turkelses, so I thought one mind.
So I have a Disney magic story for today, and I think me and Courtney could probably cry telling this story because we woke up really early this morning.
Like 1:45, 2.
Oh,
And we got in line on our, you know, to get into the security. And we thought we were okay because it wasn't too far back and everything. And so we get it into the Hall E. And, of course, they're like, the standby for the Marvel Star Wars is closed.
At 5:20 in the morning when security opens at 5. They did not stick to their plan of not letting people overnight queue. And so all of those people got in.
So we resigned ourselves to the show floor and said, okay, we're just going to do the virtual queue for shopping and go find something to do. We were going to maybe go to Women in Fashion. That was kind of interesting to us. So I'm hungry. Of course, it's 6 o'clock in the morning. Haven't eaten anything. So I go to the coffee line to go get some muffins or anything like that. And this guy in front of me is talking to this other guy about how he has an extra reservation and how much it would cost to buy that extra reservation. And he says, oh, I didn't think about how much it would cost to sell a reservation. And he's like, I'm not selling it, you know. And the guy goes, okay, well, we just had a bet on how much you would take for it. And he walks away. And I said, are you serious? Like, do you have an extra reservation? And he's like, I do. I have an extra reservation. And I was like, well, I'll take that. If And he goes, but you're in here. And I'm like, well, we're in here for the show floor. And we kind of got here in this, but we were going to get in standby. They closed the standby. And he was like, well, I don't know. Give me $100 or something. And I was like, I don't have $100, you know? And he was like joking at that point, you know, and I was like, okay. And he was like, I was like, but I'd really like to like buy you breakfast or like some food or something, a coffee. And he's like, okay, maybe. And he was like, you know, kind of talking about it. And he was like, I'd really like to do that, maybe. And just thinking about it. And then Courtney texts me. And of course, they're moving the show floor up to the top. So I'm going, okay, this isn't going to work. And I really was just getting it to give it to Courtney because she really wanted to go. And I was like, I was really just going to buy this guy breakfast for his reservation. And he, right before I leave, I go, you know, if you're serious, I'd really like it. He goes, give me your number. And I was like, okay, I'll give him my number. And I walk back to Courtney. They take us up to the show floor. And I say, again, I'm like, please, if you can, you know? And he's like, well, I have a buddy who also has a reservation who also has a plus one. And I went, and if you can find somebody to take that spot, I will gladly do it for you. And I was like, I have a sister. I have somebody I know.
Or I can sell it for $100.
And he was like, oh, well, I have to wait for my friend to get here and make sure he's okay with it. And I was like, okay. And that's fine, perfectly fine with me. And we go our separate ways, and we go up to the, I go up to the show floor. I didn't even get the coffee or the muffin because the line was too long. And we get up there, we sit down, we have our coffee and our muffin, and I get a call. And he says, okay, I've got 2 tickets. If you can get down here, I'll meet you at the top of the escalator. And I was like, we got to go, Court. High end speed. And little do we know, we're running across the main show floor trying not to be noticed or stopped. And who turns around and notices us and stops us?
Michael Vargo from D23.
He goes, Courtney, how are you? How are you having a good time? And we're like,
everything's great. Everything's good. We're actually trying to go to the Marvel panel.
Leave me alone.
There you
go.
When we told them like the shopping's working out and stuff like that. So we small talked with him, and then we like rush off because like I didn't want the guy to leave or anything. So
we rush off and go to the top of the escalators. He's there with the 2 wristbands. And
okay, now how many of you thought he was not going to be there with any wristbands?
With the 2 wristbands, brings us downstairs, brings us to where he and his friend are waiting.
in Hall E at the section about three rows deep in section A and the reservation line. And we sit and talk for hours. And their names are Patrick and Tim. And I want to say thank you, because all they wanted was a shout out on a podcast.
Patrick and Tim, the heroes of D23 2022.
So thankful, and it just made our whole entire day, because otherwise we would have gotten up at 1:45 in the morning with like 2 hours of sleep for no reason.
Well, that is a highlight, and I'm sorry I almost missed that story, but that is a good segue into...
Wait, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry to ruin your segue, but can we just rewind to like you are on a first name basis with the president of D23?
Yeah. Yes. Well, yeah, because we go to a lot of the D23 events on the lot, and Michael's always there and, you know, gets to know all of the members, the gold members. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, Bryn, now you provide a segue now into the panel.
So that's a really cool story about how those guys got you into that Marvel or whatever the panel was that we had today, because we missed it, and I want to hear all about it.
Bryn, do you mean the Studio Showcase, Lucasfilm, Marvel, and 20th Century Studios panel?
You betcha.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up.
Which should have been just Marvel, Lucasfilm, and Avatar.
No, this should have been just Marvel. So this two-hour panel... went a fraction over time to 3 hours, and it could have been 2 hours, and that would have been great. Let's just cut out the Lucasfilm stuff, okay? All right, as you can tell, I'm very ticked off at this. I'm not very happy with this presentation at all. The, Alan Bergman, he hosted this whole panel. He's the chairman of Disney Studios, came out. He brought Kathleen Kennedy out. Okay, so far, so good. We're getting now into Andor.
We did get new footage, I think. Was it new footage for you guys?
They said it was for the first time, but I didn't watch the latest one. Oh, so okay. I don't know if it's the same or not.
Okay. Yeah, because I can't speak to it because we've seen... yeah, like there's like
right.
Half of us here have seen Andor first four episodes. So I don't remember.
All right. Now, before I even go into that, I'm going to say this is probably the lamest Lucasfilm panel I've ever seen in my life. And I've seen a lot of panels... And I was so, so disappointed.
I mean, with I have all to say, I was kind of disappointed being at Celebration and getting the same information. So, you know.
Right. Yeah, it was just lackluster. And we'll buzz through this because there's not much to go through. So first was Andor, and they brought out Genevieve O'Reilly, Kyle Soller, Diego Luna, and a couple of other cast members. Who they said him so fast that I didn't.
Bix, the woman who plays Bix.
Adria Arjona.
Yeah.
Yeah, Adria Arjona.
Okay, and once again, Diego Luna really sold us on how excited he is for this show. Who got everyone else very very excited because he's bouncing up and down like he's on a pogo stick.
Yes.
So how that's so infectious, and then they showed us the trailer. Mm-hmm. And they rolled right out of that.
Yes. Now, I do want to say, before we go into this, if you are listening right now and you want to see some of this video, I did share in our Instagram stories throughout the panel. So that's at SkywalkingPod on Instagram. And there's a lot there. And I saved them in our highlights as well. So they will be saved beyond 24 hours if you want to go see some of that.
Or just go back and watch the Celebration same panel.
You know, if you put videos on YouTube, they're forever. Sorry. Yeah.
All right, so then they came out with Willow. Okay, great. Willow, and more information on Willow. Yes. Saw a little bit at Celebration. Let's see some more.
More cast.
Yeah.
I like that. We saw a trailer. Yeah, we saw a trailer for that.
This was excruciating, this segment. Oh, it was excruciating.
Oh, I loved it.
Because, okay, if you're going to bring people out for a Disney project, give them some media training. Because they would bring out some of the people. Let's go through this. They brought out Warwick Davis,
yes.
Joanne Whalley, which I didn't know she was coming back. I may have seen that. She plays Saoirse from Willow. Now she's back again.
She was at Star Wars Celebration.
Yeah, I think they revealed that at Celebration. Yeah.
I didn't see the Willow presentation at Celebration. I saw like little bits of it here and there. And I remember some of the same information that I heard at Celebration. They brought out Aaron Kellyman and This was new. Christian Slater.
Yes, that was
Christian
new.
Slater yes. is in the Willow series on Disney Plus.
Yeah, this is why I liked this presentation. This is the most I have ever heard about.
Okay,
this
then let's
series.
Let's take a step back. They showed the new artwork. They posted it for Willow. The cast turned around and kept staring and staring and staring. And it's like, okay, guys, we're back here. Let's get on with this. And you could tell they were quite nervous being up there.
Please, I think they're afraid to say anything.
Turn the attention away from me. But there's that. But when you're afraid of saying something, then you'll say, oh, I want to say this, but I can't. But these people just seem really, really nervous. And like they didn't train them on what to say. It's like, If you brought them up during Celebration, you could see them being a deer in headlights, and you know this, script out a little something for them. They have a huge teleprompter in the back of the room. Script something, but in the teleprompter it says, Aaron Kellerman responds. This person responds. But if you, they're great actors, but doesn't mean they can think on their feet. And like, you ever see Robert De Niro in an interview? He's terrible.
Yeah. I don't know, I just read the part.
I know it sounds like Harrison Ford, but I felt very uncomfortable watching this presentation.
Well, it didn't look bad from afar.
No.
From our seats, even...
Well, even don't lump me in with you, because I was too busy trying to post and stuff, so I didn't
like
get any of
I didn't
that.
Notice any... I mean, I noticed a little bit of it, but I was definitely, like, tweeting, so it went by pretty fast.
It just seemed like they were happy and, like, they were excited because they'd never seen the artwork before, so, like,
right.
it was
but,
a surprise
then,
to them, too.
But then you need the host, like Warwick Davis, to say, okay, guys, we only have 3 more minutes, so let's get now into everyone's little sound bites here. And, okay, so needless to say, I was hoping for more Willow... happiness and excitement.
Well, what did you guys feel about the trailer that we saw for Willow?
I really liked it. I think it looks really good. I think it might actually be better than the movie, which I think the movie is solid. I've just watched it again recently. It's entertaining, but I never thought it was great. I just think it's pretty good, and I think this show could be really, really good.
And I've got high hopes for the TV show.
Me too.
Oh, on November 30th, I'll be right there watching it, because I've been waiting for this since 1988. And the trailer had the brownies.
Yeah, Kevin Pollak back.
Yeah, from Willow. But the other brownie, whose name
Rick Overton?
Rick Overton, thank you.
I knew I had that in there somewhere.
Wow. We didn't see him. We saw a Mrs. Brownie.
Mm-hmm. Wait, okay. So what does Christian Slater play? And did he play anything in the original Willow?
They said that he is a friend of Mad Mardigan.
Yes.
Who is Val Kilmer's character from Willow.
Because you're not going to see much of Val.
Yeah. And I think we all know why Val's not going to be in this, because he's got the throat cancer. But at least give us a reason why Mad Mardigan is not going to be. So if you tell us, we can move on.
I don't know. I don't know anything about Willow. So I thought it was a good trailer.
Oh, the trailer was fantastic. When you have scripted parts for the actors, it's fantastic. And once again, I'll be the first one at November 30th watching this.
Different perspective. I don't know anything about Willow, so I have no questions.
So speaking of the Bad Batch.
Oh, yes. This date that has been zooming around.
Elusive
date of when Bad Batch is supposed to air. Which was supposed to be what, at the end of September?
It was supposed to be September 28th, this month.
All right, and then it was like...
Disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
Off the schedule, and now it's back, and it'll be premiering on January the 4th, 2023.
Yeah.
Which makes sense, after Andor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Split it up for Disney.
Yeah. Yeah. So maybe after Andor, roll in the Bad Batch? That would make a lot
of
sense.
Do we know how many episodes Willow is? Because will those overlap? Will Willow overlap with Bad Batch?
You know what? They did not 6. I've been writing down how many episodes of each, and sometimes they won't mention that kind of information. Mm-hmm.
But the rolling quota for Disney Plus is 6 to 8, so 8 or 9.
Okay, so it makes sense. All right, so Kelly, you were talking about the Bad Batch.
Awesome. Great.
All right, so
she has no comment.
Dave Filoni comes out and brings out...
And he was told, speed it up. 2x4 speed, because, oh my God, that guy... Like, he was like... He must have been told, like, five, 7, 10 times. Speed it up, Dave. Speed it up, Dave. Because he was up there. He was talking like this. He was like, blah, 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 blah. It was like I never heard him talk like that. He was not.
He's a slow talker. Because we were just at Celebration, and he's a slow talker. Yeah. So, yeah, he must have been told to speed it up because, because we were already.
And I'm wondering if they were going to show a trailer but decided to pull it for time's sake. You wouldn't know it because it went over an hour. So they could have showed us something.
The one thing that I had an issue with is we did not get an Ahsoka trailer because...
Oh, wait, hold on. We're not there yet. We're not there. We didn't get a Bad Batch trailer. We got nothing. And then like a minute and a half into it, Kathleen Kennedy says, oh, and tell us about Tales of the Jedi. It's like, well, hold on here. What about... I'm not over Bad Batch yet. Let's go back to that. But we went into Tales of the Jedi and they brought out Jon Favreau.
Yes.
And they said, Tales of the Jedi, three stories about Ahsoka, three stories about Count Dooku. Let's move on. Once again, my hand went up. So I got questions.
We did get a trailer.
We did get a trailer for that. But yeah, a trailer we've seen at Celebration.
We didn't get it here.
Yes, we did.
We did get a trailer.
For Tales of the Jedi. I'm sorry. I wanted more clips rather than the trailer. Yeah. We've seen trailers. I want more. Something like this, I want clips, not just the trailer. The trailer looks great with a young Count Dooku and a Qui-Gon. That looks awesome.
And Yaddle,
yes. The female Jedi we saw in Phantom Menace. Yes. Yeah. Okay, so Jon Favreau didn't come out until Ahsoka.
Yes.
We didn't get anything on Ahsoka.
We got nothing.
We got a picture. her back.
Yes.
Oh, well, yeah, it's Sabine's back, but we also got a picture of Rosario Dawson as Ahsoka, I think already seen, and we got no trailer. When I know for a fact at the Mando Plus panel, they got a sneak peek. So it was like, this is D23. You should have showed us that.
See, now this is why I'm frustrated with this whole segment of this whole panel, because of that. And they just announced the actor who's playing Ezra Bridger.
They didn't even do that.
Why not bring Sabine and Ezra out? What is wrong?
Did they confirm Ezra?
Yes, it's been confirmed.
That's been confirmed?
It came out through the trades. Lucasfilm hasn't confirmed
it. Yeah, Lucasfilm hasn't confirmed it yet.
It is confirmed because it's not.
But everybody thought they were confirming, and they didn't.
They didn't confirm.
But then this would have been an opportunity
But they didn't confirm it.
Yeah, then John Favreau came out and said a couple of words, and then
that's when I ran over to Kelly and I was like, "Richard's gonna be so mad."
Yes, because I wanted to see that trailer, something, a sizzle reel, something. I wasn't as upset as I was at Willow, but still, I was upset.
Richard is turning red right now for you listening at home.
And we'll get to why I think Lucasfilm had such a short time because Marvel was. Long.
Deservedly so, because they had a lot of trailers. And their actors had media training.
And sneak peeks.
Yes, but all right, we're jumping ahead. Let's get to Skeleton Crew. They've been shooting on this for a couple of weeks.
We got nothing.
We saw an image. We saw one image from
the
show.
Talk about awkward.
Okay, hold on. Bryn's got something to say.
So, didn't they learn their lesson from Star Wars Celebration? Like, what the heck?
No, nothing.
Hold on. Lesson in what?
Oh, just like have something?
Yes.
Like,
okay.
Don't just be like, hey, we have a thing and it's a thing, but
And we've been shooting
whatever.
On it. Next.
I think we got a longer explanation of it at Celebration. They gave us a one sentence. And again, it was the same sentence that they gave us at Celebration.
And then they brought out Jude Law, and then it was just awkward because they were like, bye.
Yeah.
And then now I can't say anything. Okay, bye.
He didn't even stop on his mark. He just did a U-turn and left.
Yeah. He brought him out and he immediately went backstage.
I think they're just two awkward guys. I think they're just awkward.
Yeah, that was Chris Ford and John Watts, the creators. And they did tell a story about how when Jon Favreau was working on Spider-Man, he was asking John Watts, who was directing Spider-Man, hey, do you want to do an episode of The Mandalorian? And he said, no, I want to do a whole series, and this is what I have.
At least they said he was from Spider-Man, because at Celebration they didn't say he was from Spider-Man, and nobody clapped.
And Skeleton Crew better be super good after this.
Yeah. I think, didn't John Watts drop out of directing Fantastic Four to make this?
Yes.
Wow.
Now it's Shackman?
Matt Shackman. Yeah. Confirmed today. Yeah.
The same guy as WandaVision. Right?
So this is about kids who get lost in the galaxy. So this is going to be a really fun series. Where are the kids? Let's bring the kids out.
They're filming, so they must be casted.
No, it's not animated. Never mind.
It's not animated. See, I don't even know.
Is it animated?
No, it's not animated.
Look animated.
No, yeah.
Live action.
We got some droid builder friends who are shooting on it right now. All right, so now let's go to Mandalorian season 3. Okay. All right, Mike, what do you got for that?
We got some.
Yes. Well, they brought out most of the regular cast members who are remaining, the ones that did not get canceled.
Right, okay. Katie Sackhoff. Amy Sedaris.
Yes. Pedro Pascal. Giancarlo Esposito.
Emily Swallow.
Emily Swallow. They asked her one question. She goes on and on and on. And she talks about how in the helmet, you know, it's less is more, less is more. And Kathleen Kennedy was like, so you're making up for that now, are you? And she's like,
yeah.
She told us a whole story about how... It was like about her dad and how her dad would just be silent when he was mad at her and just like very little movement, very little like acknowledgement. And it was a whole story. And then I think after Kathleen Kennedy goes, she's making up for it now. I think Amy goes, so I guess the armorer has daddy issues.
She's so wonderful.
Yeah, so Amy Sedaris was really funny.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't know what I'm doing here because.
Her character was.
Oh, yeah, she was saying
she's
that.
She's like, I'll be saying these
things in the script, but I've got no idea what I'm talking about.
Exactly.
They put a mullet on me and an uncomfortable costume. I'm saying things about moisture evaporators. I don't. What's an N1 starfighter? I don't know what this is. I'm getting laughs.
She said that she tries to improvise a lot on set because she comes from a comedy background, and Jon Favreau will come up to her and say, no, you can't say that in space or whatever. Yeah. So she'll have to change it to something
else.
She's
so fantastic. She's like sketch comedy from way back, and she's fantastic. I love her so much. I'm so happy she's in that show.
And when they brought all the cast out, they didn't stick to the script. They wanted to give each other hugs because they hadn't seen each other in so long. It became like a big hug fest.
Yep, that's on my Instagram stories.
All right, then they showed us a trailer, which is the same trailer from Celebration, which we didn't see, but I remember people being very excited about a tree full of Kowakian monkeys.
Yeah.
How often do you get to see that per day? A tree full of Kowakian monkeys.
I mean, there's a whole bunch of them in Galaxy's Edge.
But they're not in the trees. Or else I would have thought this was a brand new trailer, but it wasn't.
No, because I don't think it was the extended one that somebody else saw.
So. Oh.
In the Mando Plus panel. Because in the Lucasfilm one, we got a short one. And then they said they got an extended one in the Mando Plus. So.
All right. Then, and also in the trailer, Babu Frick is back.
Yes!
What?
I saw that.
What? Yes. What is
this? Guys, you weren't in the Mando Plus.
No, no, we weren't. That's why we're so excited right now. It would have been so much better if they cut to Babu and he said, hey, hey.
Well, he's kind of.
I want to hear a hey hey, but you know, I'm happy. I'm happy with what we got.
I think he was mid hey hey, like when they panned over him. So. We saw a lot of Grogu, though. A lot of Grogu.
So, Emily Swallow and Giancarlo Esposito pretty much made up for the lack of dialogue from the other.
Because again, we're lacking time.
Yes,
we're lacking time.
John Carlos said, "I don't care about your stopwatch. I got some things to say." And he just hyped up the whole crowd.
Preacher way.
Yes.
Is he a preacher?
I don't know, but his dad might be. I don't know.
It's in his background, probably.
Okay.
Oh, speaking of the Electric Company, he was one of the singers on the theme song, The Electric Company. That was one of his first jobs in 1971. How do you know about that? Today in Star Wars history.
gotta get that plug in.
So that was a great panel. I loved that segment there. And any other standouts from this?
Not that I could think of.
We covered everything.
A blur until we got some musical numbers.
Okay. Well, did we mention we Pedro Pascal was there, of course.
Yes.
He was very, very excited about being there.
Yes, he was very excited.
All right, then comes the showstopper.
Mm-hmm.
Indiana Jones 5.
Oh, yes.
All right, so when you're listening to this, grab a Kleenex.
Okay. Yeah.
So, Sarah?
Okay, so the events unfolded, you know, they put the logo on screen, Indiana Jones 5, And, you know, I'm looking around. James Mangold comes out. He's the director. And he's just explaining how he's working on this film with all his heroes that he's grown up loving, like Steven Spielberg. You have George Lucas. You have John Williams. You have Harrison Ford. Like, all these. Kathleen Kennedy, he mentioned, because she's right there.
I'd say it's notable that he did list George Lucas among his collaborators on this movie. He specifically did say that, so I don't know what contribution he might have had, but it seems like he may have had some input.
Yeah. Oh, that is good note. Yeah. And then as he's, you know, talking, I believe it was as he was talking, like, you see two figures kind of walking on stage, and one of them was Harrison Ford, and the audience leaped to their feet. He was the only person who got a standing ovation,
and rightly so.
Yes. Yes.
So he comes out with Phoebe Waller-Bridge.
Yes, thank you.
And he started tearing up,
which
made everyone started tearing up. Yeah. He was so emotional. He gave this heartfelt speech about how he's so excited about this one.
It's actually good.
Yeah, and it's going to be his last one because he's 80. He's very old, and he said he's not going to do this anymore for anybody else.
He said he's not going to fall down for you anymore.
Yes.
I think he's got at least two more in him after that.
But my favorite moment when he looks over at Phoebe Waller-Bridge and goes, "I couldn't have done it without you, and you make the film." Yeah.
Yeah, he did also say that this film is going to kick your... Mm. Ivan, close your ears. You know what.
Your tushy.
Yes, your dairy ear.
Yes. I was already emotional from the footage that we saw when he started... You know, when Harrison was... welling up. I was already welling up with tears, so that like compounded the whole thing. But yeah, just that I feel like this movie is really targeted at big Indiana Jones fans, which I definitely am. So super excited.
Ever think you were gonna see Harrison Ford tear up?
No, the man is so stoic. I've never seen him that emotional. I've seen him do a bunch of these type of public appearances, you know.
I like this Harrison Ford.
Yes.
I mean, not that I dislike the other Harrison Ford.
The early 2000s, he got into the grumpy Ford.
Yeah,
I'm sure you guys have seen now the photo of him reuniting with Jonathan K. Kwan backstage.
Oh, no. Who plays Short Round in Temple of Doom.
So they were like hugging and taking photos together. Because K. Hoi Kwan is in... one of the Marvel shows, Loki season 2. Yeah, so they got to meet up backstage, which is really cool.
Oh, great moment.
And he had some emotional moments. Harrison Ford had emotional moments at the Lucasfilm panel at Star Wars Celebration, which I happened to luck out to be in, or at, not in. But yeah, that I love this is good. He should keep going like that.
Yeah, then they showed a trailer? A trailer?
It looks fantastic.
Yeah. It does. But when you see Harrison, Indiana Jones on a horse and doing shoulder rolls, you just got to think, okay, that's not Harrison Ford.
I don't care.
But Indiana Jones should be doing things an actual 80-year-old can do. Going through a plate glass window, being chased by... couple of boulders.
You focus on the wrong things.
I have a quick tangent.
Go ahead. He's Indiana Jones.
Yes.
What other reason do you need?
Suspend your disbelief. This is movies.
I can only suspend it for so. But I'm gonna be there. I'm gonna see it. But as he's doing all this stuff, I just couldn't get my head wrapped around some of the stuff. And he's swinging over cobra pits and he's jumping through waterfalls. This stuff didn't happen. But you know, things to that effect.
We rewatched Kingdom of the Crystal Skull last year so I could talk about it with Sarah on my podcast. And I watched it with my wife. And every time there was like a stunt involving Indy, she would say like, "Oh no, his old bones." And I can't not think of that now.
See, so I'm not the only one. So have him do stuff that's realistic to someone who's 80 years old.
But realistic to someone who's 80 years old is not a movie make.
Well, okay, all right, we'll continue with that thought. Maybe they should have brought in a younger Indiana Jones. I know.
Phoebe Waller-Bridge.
Yeah, wait, are we talking about,
are we spoiling
right
anything from the footage? Are we allowed to do that?
Okay, spoiler alert.
Because it seems like, I mean, this kind of leaked out a little bit earlier, but it seems like a good portion of this movie is probably flashbacks to younger Indiana Jones.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And it looks like they've de-aged Harrison Ford in a lot of these.
Yes. So he won't be played by River Phoenix.
Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah. R.I.P.
But they did say that Phoebe Waller-Bridge is a good foil for him and in this movie.
So she's the character that should have been in the last film.
Yeah, probably.
An 80-year-old deadly game of chess.
A deadly 80-year-old game of chess.
Thank you, Ivan. No, the one shot I was really excited about, get ready for another tangent, that was when Indy grabs his whip. Whenever Indy puts his hand on that whip, you got me right there. I'll pay for that 30-second movie of just Indiana Jones with his whip, but that is exactly when a security guard passed right by us and blocked the whole shot. So I saw him grab the whip, and I saw him snapping the whip, but I didn't see anything in between. What was he doing with the whip? What was going on there?
There was lots of guns pointed at him.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll see, from where we were sitting, we saw a security guard passing by. I'm not sure that's in the film, but that's kind of my tangent to other security guards when I keep asking them to move back because we can't see, and other security guards would come over and tell me, sit down. Well, can they move? And this is like the worst security detail I've ever seen at any convention. What if there was an emergency back there? You're telling me to sit down and shut up, but listen to what I got to say here. You're blocking the media section. But that's a whole other story. That's a whole side tangent.
That's the end. And that's the end of the Lucasfilm.
Yes. And Richard's very passionate about all of this, which means it all bubbles up. But that's why we have a podcast. Woo!
Right.
I would like to mention the other thing that got me emotional about the Indiana Jones footage is the return of John Rhys-Davies as Sala. The footage opened with a voiceover, and I very quickly recognized his voice, and he's talking about how he missed his days of adventuring with Indy, and then we see him, and yeah, super excited to see him again.
So when I heard his voice, I'm thinking of the Indiana Jones ride.
Which is not John Rhys-Davies. It's one of the Disney voiceover actors.
He sounds really good.
Yes, I was shocked when I found that out.
All right.
Well,
Courtney?
We have to go, unfortunately, but we wanted to mention Rogers the Musical.
Yeah,
we want to get there.
That's where we're going to next. Yes. Okay, yes. So that's all that the Lucasfilm segment
Lucasfilm
had to give to us.
Ended.
So now we're thinking, okay, title for Indiana Jones 5? No, let's move on to Marvel.
Yeah.
Let's
get a date, though, for Indiana.
Yes, June 30th, 2023.
Yes.
Not on Disney Plus, unfortunately.
Yes, so
in the theater.
Yeah. So then Kevin Feige gets announced and comes out, and he comes out and he says that his dream was to have a musical number in the Marvel panel because everybody else gets musical numbers and he wanted a musical number. So he announces that he are going to see Rogers the Musical.
Oh my God.
And we get a whole musical number.
Entire
the entire thing. Danced, performed, sung by the Avengers in like the characters,
A band.
A band.
It was like wheeled up.
And Mark Shaiman, the composer who wrote the musical, was there conducting the band.
Yeah.
And the only thing that would have been better is if Adam Pascal was actually in it. But yeah.
Okay.
But it was amazing to see, and it was so fun. And it's everything we want. We want this to come to the Hyperion Theater at Avengers Campus.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
Yes.
That would be amazing.
We want this to come. So Parks panel tomorrow, we're crossing our fingers. I don't think it's going to happen. But but Rogers, yeah. But we were just like, we saw this in Hawkeye, and ever since, we've been talking about how we want to see Rogers the Musical. We would go see Rogers the Musical, and how can we go see it? And we actually got to go see it.
So was it like basically what we saw in Hawkeye, but just done live?
The same thing, yeah.
Oh, that's so cool.
But better because it was live.
Yeah, it's so much better. Electric. Oh, that's fantastic.
And with that, we got to go.
Yeah,
okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
We will see you ladies later.
Bye, Courtney and
Bye-bye.
Kelly. And it was sad to hear him say that this is the first and last time we'll ever have a musical during our Marvel number.
Probably.
Yeah,
he
buttoned that with a, yeah, it was the last time.
Now, Richard and I have a fun story about this Rogers the Musical. No? Okay, never mind. No, we don't have a story. I don't think we're supposed to
keep
talk
under,
about
under
it.
Our
direct
so
message them and you'll get it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe not.
Yeah.
All right.
So with that, let's move on to Black Panther.
Yes.
Black Panther 2.
Wakanda Forever.
Mm-hmm. So they brought out Ryan Coogler, the director, and this is coming out November 11th of this year. Wow,
it's coming up
the corner.
And ooh, and they gave us some great footage. But did you have?
They brought out the cast, and once again, they read their names so fast. And the big teleprompter, which I could turn around and write all their names down, it went out. I couldn't get. I know Letitia Wright was there, who plays Shuri. Angela Bassett was there, who plays Mrs. Black Panther.
Yes, Mama.
Yes. And the actor who plays Namor was there.
Right.
Yes. Don't ask me to pronounce his name.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I do want to say, I'm sorry, just cutting back to Rogers the Musical, I will upload that whole video to YouTube because I did record the whole thing in horizontal.
Oh, so nice. Yeah. And I have the introduction to that if you want to put that on there.
And we have really good seats because we're in front row in the media section.
And a security guard wasn't in our way.
Yeah. Okay. So, sorry.
So who wants to start on Wakanda 2?
I'm really excited to see Namor because I grew up reading the Fantastic Four. He was a regular character in that comic book. But Namor, of course, predates even the 60s era of Marvel Comics, going all the way back to like the 30s, like in the golden age of comic books. He was one of the first superhero characters back then. So it'll be cool to see him in live action for the first time.
Yeah, he was always the Econo version of Aquaman.
Yes. Definitely very similar.
He had nothing of an outfit, just little green trunks and wings on his feet.
Right.
I think they should have called this movie just Wakanda Forever instead of Black Panther.
Sure. Mm.
Because they did make it a point to say there's no more Black Panther in the trailer.
Well, there's no more T'Challa. I think somebody else is going to take up the mantle of Black Panther.
But in the clip, we got a clip. We didn't just get a trailer. We got a clip, which is what I love to see.
Yeah.
Give us more than a trailer. And they were at the UN, and they were all getting down on
Angela Bassett.
Like, you got this vibranium. This can be used as a weapon. Like, and she comes back and says, well, the vibranium's not dangerous. It's y'all. You guys are dangerous.
You are the dangerous people. We don't want to give that.
That's what she said. We have no king. We have no Black Panther.
Yeah. So, and then they intercut that footage of her at the UN with a scene with some bad guys trying to infiltrate.
I think they were military because they brought them in the end.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. So they were like military guys trying to steal vibranium.
Yeah.
And from this like tech station where these women were working, and they were all kind of dressed like in little science outfits or something. But then as the guys were trying to steal and like breaking into something, all of a sudden they turn around and the women had undone their outfits and they were the Dora Milaje. And they kicked
ass. What happened at that point?
Yeah, it was amazing.
So to add a button onto Angela Bassett's big speech, they brought in all these soldiers and said, there's my point. Mm-hmm. American soldiers tried to steal our vibranium, which is why you're not getting it. Because you don't know what to do with it. You're going to use it as a weapon. All right, so then let's move on to Ironheart, which I did not think we were going to see anything from.
No.
And this comes out in 2023. No date there.
Right. The showrunner is Ryan Coogler.
Is he the showrunner? I think he might just be a producer.
Okay.
He's definitely
involved in Ironheart because he stayed out to talk about that.
And I think this character, Riri Williams, will be introduced in Black Panther, Wakanda Forever, and then carry over to Ironheart.
Exactly. Yeah, that's right.
She's the new tech kid who loves Iron Man and replicates his armor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Riri Williams is Ironheart.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay, cool.
Yes.
Cool.
And they showed a trailer with Alden Ehrenreich.
Yes.
Alden Ehrenreich is in this movie. They announced this a couple of weeks ago, but they didn't say who he was going to be.
We saw one shot.
He's got long, scraggly hair. Like, that was Han Solo. That was Han Solo.
Yeah, we saw one shot.
So he's playing Han Solo, right? They're not going to have him play another character? Oh, my God, it's Marvel. I had a drink at dinner.
Okay. Hey, Bryn, I got some bad news. We're not editing these.
No, that's fine.
Okay, so Alden Ehrenreich is in Ironheart, the Disney Plus series.
In the multiverse, they all exist within the same
reality.
They
can
anyway.
Pixar. They can cross. Like Pixar.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And then Buzz Lightyear showed up.
Yay! And he was Santa Claus, right?
Yes.
Who?
Not the real Santa Claus, but the other Santa Claus.
And then Chris Evans takes over for Tim Allen, and we're all back to MCU.
Yes.
Let's do it.
And he was done arguing about not being cast as Buzz Lightyear anymore. We went off the rails. Off the rails there.
Anyway, Anthony Ramos is also in Ironheart, and the audience cheered.
He plays the Hood. Okay. And when I was at the Spider-Man panel, everyone was very excited about this character. That's all the info I got for you.
Okay. I don't know who the Hood is, but Anthony Ramos is great. He was the original John. He's in Hamilton. He was on Broadway. He was the first.
I think he's John, Lawrence.
Yeah, John Lawrence.
Yeah.
And he also
plays Hamilton's son in Act Two.
Right. And then he's also Usnavi in the movie version of In the Heights.
In the Heights, correct.
So he's great. He's lovely.
Perfect. Okay. Well, see, this is why we have a round table.
Yeah. And I feel like we should be giving more information on these, but this is all the information that we're getting. Right.
Yes.
It was pretty rapid fire.
Each segment was like
2 minutes.
Five minutes. 5 minutes at most, and that includes time with the trailer.
Yes. Yeah, so then we moved on to Quantumania, I believe.
Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania.
Yes, it does. And they brought on Justin Majors, Evangeline Lilly, and
Jonathan
Paul
Majors.
Rudd. I'm sorry. Oh, no. Whoops. Yeah. Jonathan Majors, Evangeline Lilly, and Paul Rudd. And
Paul Rudd, a.k.a. The sexiest man in the world. Right. Yes.
This was a big part of the presentation, actually.
They did 4 minutes on this, on the sexiest man alive.
You know what? I'm not complaining.
No, not at all. Not at all.
Yeah, and then they joked about how Jonathan Majors was the sexiest man alive, and then Evangeline Lilly was like, you guys, I'm the sexiest. It was funny.
So this had nothing to do with...
I got a break from tweeting because it had nothing to do with what they're talking about.
So this begins Phase 5 and is a theatrical release coming out February 23rd, 2023.
Right.
All right. Then they showed us a trailer. And I'm sure this was already released, this information. Bill Murray?
Yes. I did know that he was going to be in it.
Yeah.
Okay.
But very excited.
I don't know that. I don't know the character that he plays.
No, okay.
He's Bob the Builder?
He plays Bob the Builder.
Once again,
this again
Ivan with the non sequiturs. Yeah, this whole thing went off the rails very quickly. The whole panel, the whole segment there. Uh-huh. For the trailer, this looks exciting. This looks really, really exciting.
I'm super psyched for actually everything from now on. I mean, and the stuff we've talked about already. Everything coming up from Marvel Studios just looks so good.
It looks fantastic. And basically, Paul Rudd's daughter learns how to communicate with those in the quantum mania.
Yeah, she sends the signal to the quantum realm. What's her name?
Michelle Pfeiffer
says, wait, you sent a signal to the quantum realm? And then all...
They get sucked into the microverse.
Oh, yeah. No.
So that's cool. That's how it starts.
Yeah.
That's probably going to be like your first scene.
But boy, that scene where Kang comes out and he's talking to Paul Rudd and he's like, have I killed you before? Because it all kind of blurs together for me. I was like, oh, that's creepy and I can't wait.
Yeah. Yeah, they were all, I think Paul Rudd mentioned how Jonathan Majors was like so just off the wall to work with because he's just so... creepy.
I remember seeing him show up in Loki at the end of that season, kind of knowing that he was going to be the next like big bad of the Marvel Universe. And his performance in Loki was so exaggerated because that version of Kang to become the one who remains had been there for so long, so he kind of went crazy. So now we're seeing like a younger version or like a more together version of Kang, and it's definitely a different performance.
Wait, so Kang's going to be in Quantumania?
Yep, he's the villain of Quantumania.
I am very off on all this.
Yeah, we know nothing. It's so nice to get the recap live.
All right, next we go into Werewolf by Night.
Yes, they brought out Michael Giacchino.
And who?
Yay,
and he is the director.
He's the director
of this.
Yes.
That is cool.
Yeah, so he went to film school.
With the USC because of George Lucas.
Right. And so he had this background, but then he got into the music side because he met J.J. Abrams and started doing all that. But now he's kind of come full circle and has charge of his own series, Werewolf by Night. And do we know some info about this, Richard?
Yeah, well, this comes out next month.
That's right.
October on D23.
Yeah, they keep calling it the Halloween special.
Disney Plus.
Yeah, the Halloween special.
This is live action. And this is the comic book series that Moon Knight started it in.
Right.
Oh.
So I thought we were going to see a little bit of Moon Knight.
So it's like a live-action version of a comic book.
Yes, yes. And it's all done in a very universal horror movie style.
It's black and white.
It even looks like an old film strip, because every once in a while you'll see a jump cut, which excites me beyond belief. And the whole thing started off with a CBS primetime special. When you see back in the 70s, when they were going to preempt a TV show, you would see this little promo. The Incredible Hulk and Wonder Woman will not be seen tonight in order for the Sunday night movie. And you have those same graphics, which Michael Giacchino wrote the little theme song to this. And all the classic fans, we all gasped because we know exactly what that was.
I gasped just now when you said it was going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, when you saw that thing happening, you knew that your night was going to be awesome.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because that really preceded, like, all the Peanuts specials.
Yeah.
The Halloween and the Christmas specials. And because you knew that was going to happen once a year.
Yes.
Once, and that was it. So when you heard that little dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun, you got chills. That's all you had to see.
Yeah.
And once again, that preceded the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Right. Oh, I see. Yeah, see, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm too young. I don't know if Mike knows either.
I was alive for 3 weeks in the 70s.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, so we don't know what you're talking about.
But they did say this is going to be very dark and very scary.
Yeah.
And it looked like it is.
Yeah.
This looked very, like, this is the kind of show I'm excited for, because I want something different now. I want something that every week you're like, I can't wait until the next week. What is happening? I really want repercussions every single week.
Yeah, so I know I'll watch it, but to me the trailer kind of was like, it almost turned me off. It was a little too scary.
It was pretty out there. Yeah. And like Richard, I am excited about that because I like the weirder stuff from the Marvel universe. And I'm excited for this phase because it seems like they're going in that direction.
I mean, I'll definitely watch it. I mean, Michael.
Yeah, you will.
Well, yeah, I know I will. I'll just be interested as to how I'll respond to it, because I don't have that nostalgic feel about any of the monster movies, any of that. So, yeah.
I wish it were coming out a little bit sooner, just so it can really play through the whole Halloween season instead of just a week beforehand.
Okay.
But still, I'll take it.
Yeah.
I don't know how this. I don't know anything about the comic book other than the research we did for Moon Knight, so I've got no idea how this fits into the whole MCU. Mm. And if they're smart, they will give us a little bit of Moon Knight in this.
Is Knight in the Werewolf by Night or with a K?
No, oh, no, okay. No. Oh, good call, but no, just Knight, regular Knight.
Okay. All right,
so they brought out a couple of the actors, Laura Donnelly and somebody else.
Gael Garcia Bernal is the star.
Thank you, Mike.
Sure. He was with Diego Luna in Y Tu Mama Tambien.
Perfect.
I think he also played, I forget what his name is. Never mind.
He's like best buddies with Diego Luna.
Okay, cool. Excellent.
All right, so next they moved into Secret Invasion.
I'm super excited for this.
Tell us why.
It's like a spy thriller in the Marvel. It looks really grounded. It looks really intense.
Series.
Yeah.
A series on Disney Plus,
It stars Samuel L. Jackson back as Nick Fury, and he's trying to prevent an invasion by the Skrulls, who are an alien species that can basically look like anyone because they can shapeshift.
Which is sort of weird, because they were, didn't two of them disguise themselves as Nick and...
Yes, correct. Yes.
And Coulson?
And
no, it was
Colby Smulders, right?
Oh, right.
What's her name in the
In Captain Marvel?
Yeah, at the end when someone.
I think that was the end of Spider-Man.
Yes.
Far From Home.
Yeah. Which is weird, because they seemed like Nick Fury wanted them to do that.
Yeah, I'm not. That's a good question, because we do know that like Ben Mendelsohn's character is a good Skrull, quote unquote. So we don't know, like,
and
there might be good and bad Skrulls.
They were also, like, really, they were, like, everything was happening to them in Captain Marvel. Like, what were they called?
Skrulls?
No, not the Skrulls. The
Kree?
Yeah. Like, they were attacking them. They didn't really do anything. So I'm curious to see how that's gonna, like, why they're attacking.
All very good questions, and I hope we find out.
It's also exciting to see a whole thing about Nick Fury.
Yes.
And they said this is coming out next year.
Yes.
That's all we got on that.
That's all we got.
And Amelia Clark is in this. That was announced a couple of, like a month or two ago.
Okay. Yeah.
And we saw footage with Don Cheadle talking to Samuel Jackson in the
trailer. Yeah, that was a great scene.
Yeah.
Nice.
Once again, we got a clip, not a trailer.
Right.
Okay, from there
we went into Armor Wars, which is another, I believe it's a series?
It's a six-part series.
A six-part series that will follow Secret Invasion, and basically Secret Invasion sets up Armor Wars. And the audience went wild when they mentioned Armor Wars. It's, I guess, a very popular comic run. I don't know what it's about.
And they said it has not started filming yet, so they couldn't show us anything except tell us that Don Cheadle is in it also. So
they get a pass.
Yeah.
Okay, from there they went on to Loki 2.
Loki 2!
Wow, are we all the most excited for Loki 2?
I think so.
With no date announced.
No date, but they brought out Tom Hiddleston.
Bryn's on the floor, everybody. She's on the floor.
I have to be someplace where Tom Hiddleston is because I have to sing the song that he sings in the Tinkerbell Pirate Fairy movie when he walks by. I desperately need to him just be near me, and I'm just going to break it out, and I hope that he will know the lyrics as well.
Okay, do it, then walk away. Don't even refer to it. Don't even say, oh, hi, I'm a big fan. You sing the song, and you walk away. It will make more of an impression.
I think you're right.
I'm going to do that.
Wow.
Hey, Ivan, you know your mom is married, right?
I've been looking up for
to your father.
I meant like say hi.
Just to be friends with him.
Sweet.
That's very sweet, Ivan. Okay, they also brought out Owen Wilson.
You can see him.
And Kaigi Kwan. From Temple of Doom.
Ki Hui Kwan, I think, is the pronunciation.
I wrote it down phonetically as Kai Gui Kwan.
Something close, yeah, sure. I think it's K E H U Y Q U A N. But
and the actress who played Sylvie. Sophie.
Yes. Mm. Sophie.
Stumped me on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should have. Okay, Sarah's looking it up as we speak.
Yeah, she was there. Yeah, they were all. They were there, yeah.
Okay, Bryn's looking up here. So, Sarah, tell us what you think about the trailer.
Okay, well, I was super excited to hear about Loki. At this point, though, in the presentation, they had showed us so much stuff that now I can't remember unless someone...
Well, it opened with Loki. He's, become unstuck in time, like Billy Pilgrim from Slaughterhouse-Five. Sorry, I just got nerdy on you right there.
Yeah, you did, because I don't know what that is. But it's a Kurt Vonnegut novel. They showed him, being kind of time-warped as he's, different parts of his body. Like, he's in the TVA, and he's,
he's being pulled through time. Pushed and pulled through time.
Yeah, pushed and pulled through time. And then it seems like no one knows who he is. Like, he was dumped back in the TVA at the end of season one, and now... No one knows who he is. And so it's like the story is restarting. Something.
And there's a part where he smashes through the mural and the TVA and the there's a statue of Kang behind the mural.
Yeah. It's like he smashed the wall through time or something. I don't know.
So I've got the actress's name who plays Sylvie. Her name is Sophia DiMartino.
Thank you. Yes. Perfect.
Thank God for iPhones.
I know. I know. And Yeah. So, yeah. And I don't remember her saying much. I mean, they would literally ask one question of each, you know.
They're all basically shooting these series as we speak.
Yeah.
So they got jet lag. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they don't remember what they just shot and what they can say and what they can't say. So pretty much the gist of everything was, you guys are going to have a great time with us. We can't wait for you to see it. Next.
Moving on.
Yes, that's pretty much the gist of everybody.
But I am super excited, and that's going to be sometime next year, is what they said?
They didn't say. Then they never said what.
Mention, but they're shooting.
Yes.
Yeah. So then we have Echo.
Before that, they said, and in the audience is Matt Shankman, who is doing Fantastic Four.
That's right.
We don't have anything but a logo.
Yep.
And moving on to Echo.
Yes. Too bad for you.
Yeah.
Too bad for you, but we have this thing we're not going to tell you about.
They said, we're not going to bring Matt up because we got nothing.
Yeah.
It's really bizarre because in the weeks leading up to D23 Expo, all the casting for Fantastic Four leaked, and all the casting for, well, Ezra casting leaked for Ahsoka. So we all kind of expected that to happen on stage today, and it didn't. So I wonder if they changed things because of the leaks, or
just,
I don't know.
Just bring John Krasinski back up.
Right.
Yeah. Bring them all up, since like that was all of the talk.
That's what the whole point of this is.
Yeah.
Okay, so then we had Echo, and Echo is a series. It looks really interesting. It looks like they're gonna really go heavy into the fact that Echo, she's Native American, and they're gonna dive into that backstory of how her ancestry, you know, has built her into what she is today, into this superhero. That ties back to her ancestry of Native American, and also she's deaf. So this series is very, very big on representation, and yeah.
Right, wait, is this the character who was in Hawkeye?
Yes.
Oh, yes, we saw a tiny bit of this on the show floor. Yeah, that's great. I'm really excited about this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm so glad they're really delving into the inclusion of having special need superheroes and villains and such.
That too, yeah, I love that, and I love the Native American touch on this too, because I feel like I need to learn more. I just love learning about cultures, so I think this is a fun way to do it.
And I was thinking during that part of the trailer that there's a couple other Native American Marvel characters from the comics that I wonder if they'll use this as an avenue to bring them in. Just
I'm sure
curious.
And then who else do they bring back from the dead? Kingpin.
Yep.
Yes. The last episode of Hawkeye, Echo shoots Kingpin, but the camera pans up before you see what's happened to him.
Right.
In the trailer, we see him with a damaged eye.
He confronts Echo, oh, remember me? And then he came out on stage, Vincent D'Onofrio.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I was...
He sounds nothing like
Kingpin.
No, not
at all. Not at all.
It's so funny.
Is he as tall as he was in the show?
No, he's just a normal guy.
D'Onofrio is like a chameleon. I feel like he looks and sounds different in every role that he performs. Yeah,
definitely.
At the Spider-Man panel, some of the guys were saying, we were at Disneyland the other day, and we saw Vincent on Smuggler's Run.
Oh.
A picture of Kingpin in the Millennium Falcon cockpit would have been priceless. Priceless.
Yes.
Okay, and the trailer was closed captioned, which I thought was a nice touch.
Yes, I thought that was great. I wish they would have done that for all the trailers, because I know we are getting old. We watch everything closed captioned in our house.
I blame it on poor sound mixes.
That too, yeah.
That the dialogue gets mixed in with sound effects and music, and it's like, okay, what level is what? All right, from there, we moved on to Daredevil Born Again.
Yes.
And I'm so glad this is Born Again on Disney Plus. And they said 18 episodes.
Wow.
18 episodes. That's a lot of episodes. Starts shooting next year, so they didn't have anything to show us. Or did they?
Oh, I like the way they, if just like rewinding a couple minutes, I like the way they introduced this part of the presentation, because everybody from Echo like left the stage and Vincent D'Onofrio was just kind of hanging around there.
Yep.
And Kevin Feige was just like, why are you still out here? And
that's
like,
right.
Oh, aren't we going to talk about my show?
Show?
Yeah.
Yes, Vincent D'Onofrio said, aren't we going to talk about my show?
That's when Charlie Cox, who plays Daredevil, came out.
Yeah.
And to see the two of them butting around, it's like, no, I don't want to see that.
No, right? You're supposed to be enemies.
Fighting.
Yeah, it was cute, though. They were so comfortable on stage.
Yeah.
Like, they really...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It was fun to see them together.
Cosplay of Daredevil today when we were on our way in.
Oh, nice. Cool. Now, since they didn't have a clip because this hasn't started to shoot yet, what did they show us?
The clip of Daredevil's cameo in She-Hulk.
That's right. Coming up.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Or part
really
of it, because it seems like there'll be before and after. But yeah, we got one scene of that.
Yeah. It was very cute, and they had a really good rapport. And they even had a little moment together, a little steamy moment.
Right.
Yeah, so this is
like,
before
ooh.
Jen Walters turns into She-Hulk.
Yeah.
Yeah. He can hear her heartbeat a little bit faster when she's around him.
Oh, sweet. Oh, I love that.
Because Daredevil is saying it, you know what? There's 18 henchmen around.
Yep.
She's like, how do you know that? I can hear their heartbeats like I'm hearing yours, which is beating pretty rapidly.
And his face is, he's leaning.
Yeah. And she's a little Twitter-pated at that point.
Yeah, she is. Yeah. I mean, I would be.
All right, so 2 minutes later, they went into They went into Captain America New World Order.
Yes, which they showed a fantastic logo, which has your typical Captain America, the words in front of the Captain America star, but instead of the shield behind the star, you have the wings, and it looks really neat. Yeah, and it kind of flew in. It was neat. Yeah. And so they are billing it as a paranoid thriller and a wild ride. And Anthony Mackie says that everyone is jealous of his sex scenes. So I don't know what's going to happen about that. Wow. I know.
And Tim Blake Nelson is back. I was trying to remember what Marvel movie he was in before.
He was in The Incredible Hulk.
Oh, that makes sense.
He was the one. They've been showing clips of this recently because of the whole gamma radiation, because he got some of that. And some of the clips they've been showing on other shows, just to remind you who he is, his head is pulsating, his head is growing.
Right. The leader is the character.
The leader, yes. Name, called the leader, yes. So he's got some gamma radiation in his blood.
They've been referring back to The Incredible Hulk a lot.
A lot, yes.
And that movie is not on Disney Plus, so it's hard to rewatch.
Right.
Because it's owned by Universal.
Is Tim Blake Nelson the actor who played a Marvel character on the Marvel show that was on HBO?
Ooh, which Marvel show would that have been?
What was it called? I know.
What year?
It only recently, a few years ago.
A few years ago.
It was the one that
Oh, are you thinking about Watchmen?
Yes,
which,
Watchmen.
Which, that's DC.
Oh.
Bryn. Yeah.
My sangria is just lasting. I'm going to stop talking now.
He was great in that show, though. Tim Blake Nelson is awesome. Yes. He's got the metal mask. I don't remember the name of the character. But a great actor from a bunch of great movies.
Did they battle Rolex?
Watchmen. See, I got it. Not a non sequitur.
Wow.
And they also brought out Carl Laemmle, who plays Isaiah. He was the one from Falcon the Winter Soldier who he got also injected with the super serum.
Oh, yes.
And they put him in jail.
Right. And they teased that he would become, I guess, the leader? Is that the name of the
character? Leader is Tim Blake Nelson's character.
Okay.
So he is really a super soldier.
Okay.
But they didn't want all these super soldiers running around, so they put him in prison, of course.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's other reasons there.
Oh, Isaiah. Yes. Sorry. All right.
Did they say who's directing that or anything? Do we know anything about the...
Julius something.
Okay.
I don't remember his name.
Who's got an iPhone?
Oh, we all do.
You look that up while I talk very, very slowly and say that they did not announce when this was going to be hitting a theater near you.
No, they did not. But we are going to get a connection with the next Marvel thing that they're going to announce, which was Thunderbolts. We got some casting news. But before we get there...
Julius Ona, O-N-A-H, is the name of the director of Captain America New World Order.
Excellent. All right. So then, moving on, Thunderbolts... We finally got confirmation, and I know the internet has been swirling. Okay, these have been part of Thunderbolts in the Marvel comics, so this is who could come, you know. But we finally got an announcement and a picture of Thunderbolts. So we have, of course, Valentina de la something-something.
Contessa.
Julius Louis-Dreyfus. Okay. And she came on stage, and she brought several of her crew members. So let's see. They had... Ghost is one of the
right. She's from
Thunderbolts.
Ant-Man and the Wasp.
Yes, correct. Ant-Man and the Wasp. We also had Red Guardian.
Yes. David Harbour.
David Harbour came out.
Yay, Crimson Dynamo.
Yeah, and he was very energetic.
Yeah.
Very, very energetic.
He was. Let's see, we also...
Wyatt Russell.
Thank you, Wyatt Russell, and he's the U.S. Captain, agent.
Yeah.
And Taskmaster.
I tried to get a boo going.
Yeah. Yeah. It's okay.
But it's okay for a character like that.
Right.
You're in character. You're not booing him because of you don't like him. You're booing his character, which means he did a good job.
Exactly. And then Taskmaster is going to be, and she was in
Black Widow,
the film.
Oh, I'm excited about this.
Yeah, and the final announcement,
Florence Pugh.
Florence Pugh came in through a video message saying, hey, sorry, I can't be here.
Yep. She's too busy getting into spats with Olivia Wilde. Oh, boy. To be.
Okay.
Sorry.
Didn't they? Are they still arguing in this week? We don't know.
But Florence Pugh plays Black Widow's sister.
Yeah, we couldn't think of her name today. I was trying to. There were a lot
Yelena
of
Yelena or something.
Yelena. Yeah, and then finally, they save this for last. Sebastian Stan will be a part of the team as well.
So this is like
Bucky Winter Soldier,
a Suicide Squad type of movie. All villains.
Yeah.
That the Contessa is putting all together for her own Avenger type of group. And this starts shooting next year, so we didn't get any kind of trailer or anything.
Is it a series or a movie?
They didn't say, but I would assume it's a movie.
I think it's a theatrical movie.
I think it's a movie.
Yeah.
I think they announced like most of the series first, and then they moved on to the movies.
Yeah.
So that was a really exciting announcement.
Mm-hmm.
And then that dovetailed into my favorite part of this Marvel section, besides Rogers the Musical, and that is the Marvels.
Yay! Woo! Yay, Marvels!
So the Marvels, we have Brie Larson back as Captain Marvel. She came on stage. We got to see Ms. Marvel, Kamala Khan.
She is just so adorable.
Oh my gosh.
She is so adorable.
And then Tiona Paris, who plays...
Monica Rambeau.
And all three of those ladies came out. And their chemistry together is so cute. And then we saw footage of the Marvel series. And I think, oh my gosh, this looks like so much fun because you have all this like splendor of like Captain Marvel. You know, you have like the star powers and everything. But then it's tempered by the really funny Ms. Marvel like vibe a little bit with her young vibe and her fun. And Goose! We saw Goose in the series too. So I'm like super excited for this because I know the Ms. Marvel series was a little like, whoa, it's like a little out there for me. But I loved her spirit. And so it's like they're bringing that spirit into this.
And her whole family. I was surprised because we got to know them in the show. And now we get to see them in the movie again.
Yeah.
That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, I just can't get enough of the actress who plays Miss Marvel.
I'm not going to know that one.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Kamala Khan is the character.
Right.
She's just so lovable. Mm-hmm. You're going to want to watch anything she does just because she's just... She is that 16-year-old character.
Yeah, and she was like jumping up and down on
the
stage.
Yeah, yeah. And adorable. To see her with Brie Larson, she and Captain Marvel just together, because since she pined after her in the whole series, now here they are together on stage. It was just a great moment.
Yeah, and it's Iman Vellani.
Right.
Is the actress.
Was that the first time they met?
I don't know. Definitely not the first time they met.
During the shooting of the movie.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And the director of this film is Nia DaCosta. And she just was owning her time on stage as well. Like, you can tell she really has a good handle on this film. And it just, like I said, it's like a mix of powerful women, humor of Ms. Marvel, and just the chemistry together of the characters in the scenes, too, was out of this
And
world.
Sam Jackson's in this one as well.
Yes. And it's going to be streaming July of 2023. Very excited.
Streaming.
About that. Oh, that's
this
what it
is. This is.
Oh, did I?
I'm getting.
Up?
I thought this was going to be.
I think it's
theatrical.
Oh, okay.
I'm pretty sure.
Okay.
I hope you're right.
I know. I
hope it is streaming.
I think Rich and I are on the same page. We never want to leave our houses.
Same.
So, okay. But if it's not streaming, just wait until a month later, and it will be streaming.
Yeah.
So that wrapped up
the. It's a film. It is a film.
Yes.
Okay.
Film. What, 6 days long?
Yeah, exactly. We're not done yet.
Yeah, we're two-thirds of the way there.
Exactly. But at this point, they had done the Marvel segment. That wrapped up. We're like, okay, good, let's get up. But hold on. We need to announce 20th Century Films. come on.
Is that still a thing? Okay.
Come on.
Which was pretty much...
And I'm thinking, okay... If they say they're talking about the reboot of Planet of the Apes, I'm right here. They didn't. But they went
or
to
the
other.
Reboot of The Sound of Music, sure.
But we know Planet of the Apes is coming, and it was just casting news. So I thought they're going to mention Planet of the Apes, but they mentioned that other little indie film that no one saw back in 2009, Avatar.
Avatar, The Way of Water.
Yeah, so the.
Not seen
Wait, this is the big Avatar?
No, Avatar. No, the sequel is Avatar The Way of Water.
Oh, okay.
And not Avatar The Last Airbender.
Yeah, I was going to say, because we like that one.
Actually, no, it's off.
And then, so they didn't show us a trailer. They showed us clips, which made me happy.
Yes. Oh, but they turned the whole theater. Well, okay, so first of all, James Cameron is in New Zealand, like, finishing up.
Yeah, he came in through a Zoom call.
A live Zoom call feed. And
I'm wondering if that was live.
Yeah.
Or it was just really rehearsed, so you get the whole back and forth.
I don't know.
It kind of looked like it was pre-recorded, but that's neither here nor there. He came out, told us how excited he was. He's been doing underwater photography for like 10 years in preparation for this. And then they gave everyone 3D glasses because we're going to see a couple of clips.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so we did. We saw 5 clips from the film. And I realized...
Before we go there, we skipped over the whole cast came out.
Yes, the cast.
Sigourney Weaver. Zoe Saldana came out.
Yeah, she got a big cheer. And then the
Sam, I'm trying to remember the main guy's name.
The guy that was in every movie in 2009.
Yes.
And Terminator Salvation.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
He was in Clash of the Titans.
Right.
And then they brought out...
Sam Worthington. No, it just came to me.
Unfortunately, no.
Sam Worthington, yes.
And they brought out the new kids who are going to be in the film.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so they came out... and they each said a little something.
They skipped Sigourney Weaver and then came back to her.
Yes, that's true. Yeah, but they were all like super enamored with the story and said, oh, it's about family. And now I guess, that was funny. Actually, Sam Worthington and Zoe Saldana, they, you know, like since they filmed Avatar, they have both had families. And now in this film, it's the same like, in the film, the original Avatar, they just got together, right? And then in this one, now they have a family. So, but they were quick to say, oh, we didn't have a family together. Like, actually, you know, like in real life, you know, it was separate. But there's
significant others, they had to say that.
Yeah, exactly. It was funny. But, so it's like about family. And so I guess we'll find out. But we were shown this footage, which looked beautiful. But I realized that I haven't seen the 2009 Avatar in so long, I have no idea of the story. So they were like saying things together with context relating back to the 2009 film, and I didn't know what was going on in this.
Ironically, it's like one of the biggest films of all time, but it was in the zeitgeist for a blip.
Yeah, because of the 3D.
Yeah.
Like that's pretty much why everyone went to see it, because it was like the first big 3D film.
It was James Cameron.
Right.
That was the whole draw of it. And they're going to release Avatar
That's
again.
That's exactly actually how James Cameron wanted you to watch it. It was on the back of a seat on an airplane.
He was talking from his live feed. Oh, and we have the 4G and the Google and the Atmos Dolby blah, 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 blah. And we're like, okay, this panel's 3. How long is this panel?
You're not going to show the movie, are you? But they showed these clips, and once again, these were beautiful. Oh, my God.
They're in water.
I could taste that water.
Yeah.
It was so in your face.
Yeah, cinematography in that movie is really good, but I just didn't love the story. It wasn't very good. Yeah.
I would agree with that. I was surprised to see that apparently the Na'vi and humans can have children together.
Yeah.
Because there's like halves and halves and halvesies.
Na'vi children person. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Indeed. And what was interesting about this, we learned that, you know, in the original film, they ride those air creatures. I forget what they're called.
But Banthas.
Now they ride water
banshees,
creatures.
Actually,
yeah,
right?
So they banshees, have to you're right. With.
Yeah. Banshees. I knew it was something like that.
Oh, my God. How do you guys remember this no,
only
stuff?
Because of the theme park.
Yeah.
Only because of the Animal
Kingdom.
For some
reason, Bantha was conjured in my head.
Yes.
Animal Kingdom, Walt Disney World, yeah.
Now, after we'd seen the 5 clips, I was good.
Oh, after 3 clips, I was. After that first clip, I was good.
Yeah, I was like, okay, I don't need to see the movie. But we have a Skywalker who worked on it, so for his benefit, we'll see a screening.
Yes. So, I mean, they looked beautiful. We have no context as to the story. And then the panel just kind of ended. It was really weird.
Give us back your glasses. Now get out.
Yeah.
Everybody was so enthusiastic through
Marvel.
Some parts of Lucasfilm.
Yeah.
And then all of Marvel. And then Avatar just got like polite applause.
Yeah, and that was it. Tired. It's been three hours.
You needed a meal. Yes.
We needed an intermission.
It was 1 p.m. at this point.
We needed an intermission at that point.
Many. 11? No, it started at 10. Oh. 11, then, 12, 1.
When we, yeah. Okay, when we leave, we're going to get some nice swag. No.
It was an Avatar poster. An Avatar poster.
Which we just said, and you guys keep it.
An Avatar lens cleaner.
Oh, I do like that cleaner. For the 3D glasses.
Like lens clean car cloth.
I asked them, can we keep the 3D glasses? Like, no, but you can keep the lens cleaner. It says Avatar on it.
Okay.
You can't it's have cool. it. If you blue. Wear glasses, you can't have too many of those.
That's true.
It's blue, and it better
My
be
glasses
blue.
Are cleaner now than they were all weekend, so no complaints. Thank you, James Cameron. I forgive you for making me miss the Muppets Christmas Carol anniversary
saw your
panel.
I tweet about that. Oh, I'm so sorry.
I don't really forgive you. I was kidding.
So that wrapped it up. Yes. That wrapped the whole panel. And that was a.
That was fun.
Now, the other panels we had seen at other D23s, it would just every single segment would just energize us. We would feed off that energy. We were so just pulsating with electricity. And this we walked out, it's like, can we go to lunch now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I like being positive, but I like to also be critical when need be. Just so nothing's all whitewashed into like great, everything's all great, fantastic, because what's the point in listening if there's no yin and yang? Mm-hmm. So there you go. There you have it. So let's wrap it up now by giving the mic over here to Mike Celestino and tell us once again where we can find you and your podcast.
I'm going to do this better than I did it last night. Please visit laughingplace.com for all your Disney news and opinions and listen to Who's the Bossk? It's our Star Wars podcast weekly on laughingplace.com.
Oh, you've been rehearsing.
Nice. And Bryn and Ivan, where can we find you?
Wandering the halls of D23 Expo tomorrow with no actual panel plans.
And your home address?
Okay. Yeah. On Twitter, I am Brynane.
And Instagram, right?
Yeah, probably. Okay. Okay. I don't remember. I never post on Instagram, but I'll follow people.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Yay. And Ivan is
I live at home.
Anonymous, yeah.
Yes, he is anonymous, yes.
All Perfect. Right, so let's wrap it up by saying, never land on Alderaan.
I'm getting there.
And once again, I am very excited for Willow.
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.